Samoa, Fiji, Jamaica, Barbados, the Maldives. They've got extraordinary biodiversity and natural resources that support our planet.
But right now, these island nations are at risk.
Climate change is having a significant impact. Those disasters are negatively impacting economies. How can we make our small island nations more resilient?
There's a lot of natural resources in these oceans that can be harnessed, and that's where we're seeing a lot of innovation.
Collaboration can create this sustainable pathway into a really vibrant blue economy.
Protecting small island nations, it's protecting the world.
Small island developing states are a group of island nations around the world that face unique social, economic, and environmental vulnerabilities. But they are hugely important to the planet.
Their oceans regulate climate. They have coral reefs that sustain 12% of the world's fisheries.
Their coastal ecosystems, like mangroves and seagrass meadows, can capture carbon up to 40 times more efficiently than forests on land.
These islands contribute less than 1% of greenhouse gas emissions, yet they suffer disproportionately.
Climate change is causing rising sea levels, contributing to natural disasters like hurricanes and storms. In 2019, the Bahamas experienced Hurricane Dorian, and it created about $3.4 billion in damage to the Bahamas, which was one-fourth of our GDP.
A lot of these island nations are torn between the cycle of recovering from natural disasters and then trying to invest in growth. So the opportunities for growth are limited. How do we make that debt more sustainable? And how do we support them to become more resilient so we can break that cycle? We think of these islands as small, but the amount of ocean they control is about 28 times larger than their land size.
By harnessing natural resources surrounding small islands, wind, water, sun, sand, they can create what's described as a blue economy.
They're large ocean nations. The blue economy, whether fisheries, renewable energy, aquaculture, there's a lot of natural resources in these oceans that can be harnessed. Nature-based solutions were the original technology. And it's using the services that nature provides us for free, and it's leveraging those services in order to make ourselves more resilient. It's a business opportunity. Creating a resilient world, investing in nature-based solutions, at the end of the day, reduces their costs, reduces their risks of being viable into the future, and creates a return on investment.
Each country has to determine where its strengths are and making sure that we monetize them. We have limited resources, we are remote, we are big ocean states, and therefore we've got to determine what international financiers, what would attract them to us.
In principle, it seems very simple. Harness nature and work with local communities through global investment to create both physical and financial resilience that benefits not only the islands, but the wider world. But is there a pathway to actually achieve it? And which industries will become the pillars of this vibrant blue economy?
It's very, very important for small island developing nations to come up with programs and projects that are sustainable, that are profitable. In the Bahamas, we are very proactive. The Bahamas has the largest area in the world of seagrass beds. That is being monetized. They are so valuable to the Bahamas because of the role that they play in mitigating climate change. Per acre, seagrass beds sequester more carbon than the Amazon rainforest. The government believes that we can collect annually about $300 million in terms of carbon credits. And so that puts a valuation on the seagrass beds at about $50 billion. With this added income, we would be able to manage natural disasters a lot better.
Tourism and hospitality has a unique opportunity to enhance resilience and sustainability by integrating nature-based solutions into their business models for the benefit of the whole world. No other industry has a greater effect on the landscape.
Because tourism plays such a huge role of the economy, they can create this sustainable pathway into a really vibrant blue economy.
When these resorts are being built, often the old way was to cut down everything and then to try and landscape it back to what looked like a normal natural area. When the hospitality industry approaches a development and goes, what is there already? What nature, what landscape is there, and what services is it providing to us that we can leverage and enhance? That changes the whole equation and it changes the development and the sustainability.
An example is Soneva, a luxury resort operator which has spent the last 20 years learning to harness nature across small island developing states.
I think Soneva Foundation Coral Restoration Program is definitely one of the pioneers of preserving and conserving natural assets. The state of the coral in the Maldives at the moment is not good. The dream is to rehabilitate and restore the coral reefs around all the Soneva properties in the Maldives as our benchmark. Then what we hope to do, of course, is spread our techniques to other island communities around us to actually create a string and a community of healthy coral reef systems. This is just two of the 264 species of coral that you can find in the Maldives. We're trying to grow both of those in our laboratory at the back, in our land nurseries on plugs, and also in our rogue nurseries. If a really small island in the Maldives can actually create over 150,000 corals that we can outplant per year, anyone in the tourism sector should be considering what they can do as a sustainable footprint that actually nurture the same place that they get all of their benefits and revenue from.
Putting nature at the heart of solutions can protect investments, resorts, fisheries, and communities, all while being economically smart, creating new jobs and getting returns on investments.
The opportunity is extraordinary. The responsibility to do it is very important.
Nature-based solutions are a key tool that the hospitality industry can use. But when it comes to recovery, there's another sector that can help by rewarding and strengthening these investments in nature.
There's loads of opportunity for the hospitality and insurance industries to work together. Thinking about how the hotels and resorts themselves can purchase insurance or invest in the nature and invest in their communities. Insurance is essentially a promise to pay when the unexpected or the unthinkable happens. What has to go hand in hand with that is the adaptation and resilience measures that are being taken. Of course, the more resilient you are, the more likely it is that you're going to have a lower risk price. The United Nations estimates that $6 billion a year in nature-based disaster risk management can save around $360 billion in avoided losses. I don't think we need any more evidence to prove to us that investment in nature is a smart investment. The numbers speak for themselves.
Investment in small island nations has the potential to be lucrative, whilst at the same time, being crucial to global climate solutions. But how do they encourage investment in the first place?
Without finance, nothing's going to happen. That's the truth. Often I hear from investors that, well, there's no projects to invest in, and nothing could be further from the truth. There are projects out there. It's just that the two sides are not usually together in the same room. We need the government and we need the hospitality industry working very closely together.
The Commonwealth Secretariat, in collaboration with Cambridge University, have come up with a product called Compass. It provides a pathway to international funding in a very efficient way in terms of small island developing states partnering together and coming up with solutions, sharing resources, and then it de-risks projects. Compass attempts to provide small island developing states with financing so that they are less reliant on major lending institutions for solutions. There's got to be collaboration between countries, collaboration between the government and lending agencies, the government and insurance companies.
But how do we know when these solutions are working? With advances in data and measurement, particularly from satellites, do we have what we need to give investors confidence?
Many industries and companies are reluctant to invest in small island developing states because they see risk. But with new technology, with our world being more connected, a lot of those risks are now lower. When we're asking people to invest in innovative solutions involving nature, we need to be able to identify and quantify it so that we know if they're working. It gives an investor confidence to know that there is an outcome that is predicted. We have the science, we have the know-how. What we need is the will to do it and then do it.
Small island developing states are worth paying attention to and investing in because the solutions can be scalable.
Collaboration is essential. None of us can do this on our own.
We'll continue to work with the small island developing states and sending people on the ground to really understand the situation and work in partnership with the local communities to build those solutions.
We are all in it together, and the private sector has to join with the government because the government can't do it alone.
Nature-based solutions is not a Trojan horse for conservation. It's a real solution.